general pediatricians, and that's what Ismail wanted me to concentrate on. Because this faculty of speakers know everything that is already there. So I don't think I have anything much to add to all of what all you know. So this is Ismail's heading to my topic. ஹலோ கொஞ்சம் புரியுற மாதிரி சொன்னா கேட்போம்ல நிறைய சொல்லிட்டாங்க நான் என்ன சொல்ல போறப்பா எல்லாரும் சொல்லிட்டாங்க நிறைய சொல்லிட்டாங்க ரொம்ப ரொம்ப சொல்லிட்டாங்க நான் சுருக்கமா வரைஞ்சு
பாக்குறேன்
PCOS so they said they know about hirsutism irregular periods then they said acne obesity metabolic syndrome and elevated testosterone And they also seem to know about everything. Then they said you can see polycystic ovaries on ultrasound. And then psychologically, they said the adolescents are upset about that. And as such, adolescents are an upset group. And then in pediatric endocrinology, the group I'm really worried about is children, adolescents having diabetes. That's the really, really difficult theme that you have to speak to. I would say weight loss has an important role in PCOS, and that's what the pediatricians told me. And then they said diet and exercise plays an important role in management of PCOS. Metformin could be used for insulin resistance. OCPs are used for irregular periods, and fertility issues are a problem in adulthood. So why should we know about this? Could we have done something to prevent this? What could we have done, and when should we have done this, or should we have referred early and to whom? So what are the long-term risks of PCOS? All of us know about that elevated male hormones in girls, menstrual irregularities. But you should also remember that all, just a minute. You should also know that all girls have, you should remember Artha Narishwara. So you are a part male and you're a part female, which actually exists in everyone, which also a part in girls where you have male and female hormones. So you have to know when the proportion becomes a little bit different, it's not huge, it's only a slight difference, and then it carries on into a number of risks for both short term and long term. And then you also remember about reproductive morbidity and infertility. So in India, it is important to have children. Though I'm seeing a shift in the paradigm, a lot of young girls now don't want to have children, even if they're married and if they can have children. So it's actually becoming easier, and families are also having much more realistic expectations now and are willing to listen to what could be done for them. And then type 2 diabetes mellitus, and then insulin resistance, hypertension, dyslipidemia, I think everybody has spoken about it. I'm not going to talk about it. So modifiable risk factor, unmodifiable risk factor. நமக்குன்னு எழுதி வச்ச சொத்து நம்மளா சேர்க்கிற சொத்து வாட் யூ ஆர் இன்ஹெரிட்டிங் ஃப்ரம் யுவர் ஃபேமிலி சம்டைம்ஸ் யூ கெட் ஜீரோ சம்டைம்ஸ் யூ கெட் லாட்ஸ் வென் யூ கெட் ஜீரோ யூ ஆர் ஹாப்பியர் வென் யூ ஹாவ் அ ஹிஸ்ட்ரி ஆஃப் பிசிஓஎஸ் இன் த ஃபேமிலி பட் வென் யூ இன்ஹெரிட் அ ரிஸ்க் ஆஃப் பிசிஓஎஸ் ஸோ யூ ஷுட் ரிமெம்பர் யூ கேன் ஆக்சுவலி இன்ஹெரிட் அ ரிஸ்க் ஆஃப் பிசிஓஎஸ் ஃப்ரம் யுவர் மாம் ஸோ இட் ஷுட் பி அ unmodifiable risk factor. So you cannot alter that, but you can alter what you can do. Dr. Newton was talking about how children born small for gestation age should not be allowed to feed too much, and then he said it compromises growth. But when you are on a regular follow-up, you should not push food into the child. Children with catch-up weight, trying to catch up on weight, please monitor the length and the height that are much more important for long-term health rather than looking at weights. So I would say look at length, which is a very, very important mark of nutrition, and give less importance to weight. So length would be much more important. And even in that, you should remember only 10% of children born small for gestation age have significant growth failure. And those are who fail to catch up growth at 2 years of age are the ones we are going to monitor. So I think pediatricians are in a very, very niche or a very niche environment. You are with the family, they love you, they respect you, they listen to what you say. So you can always tell the family you're going to keep this child on a very close follow-up and follow them up long-term and keep a close watch. Always tell them before the thing. Prevention is better than cure. There's no point in asking them, telling the adolescents after they start, I mean, you should talk to children before they reach adolescence. They will listen to you. Once they reach adolescence, they think you're a stupid person. And I think Ismail can always, I mean, accept what I say. You are a better friend for your son's friend than your own son.
Yes, absolutely.
So keep track for your friends. Keep track of your children's friends. You can get so much more out of them, and they will listen to you and take your point across to that child. Your son is not going to listen to you. He knows his parents are idiots. He knows everything better than both of them do. And they actually only know to yell at them and can't listen to what they say. They are already born with a preconceived idea or stepping into adolescence with a preconceived idea. So the best person into the situation is the friend of your child. So I think that way you monitor these children from being born SGA. Don't push food into the mouth. I see educated, well-educated mothers, if they are at home, I always say, an idle mind is the devil's workshop. And that is perfectly fitting for moms who are educated and who are sitting at home and have nothing more than to do rather than stuffing food into the child's mouth. That is like a dustbin. You don't want to waste anything. As soon as the child opens the mouth, something is stuffed in. And then after some time, they lose the sense of satiety and the sense of appetite. When you start stuffing in food by 10 months of age, the child, that is when they start appreciating what is appetite. And then they also know, okay, I'm full. I've had enough. I don't want any more. And they say, no, just leave them alone. Don't feed them again. Stop feeding children. So I think that is one important point. That is a point where you should have started prevention for PCOS. So stuffing food in, when the child says no, let them go. They can eat one mouthful. I always tell families, the child can eat one mouthful and can run 100 kilometers. I mean, that might look like 100 kilometers to you, but they have enough energy to run means they have enough energy in them. You don't have to stuff food into them. So children who are force-fed, again, develop obesity. I think these are the points. I'm only trying to touch points because everything else has been done, Ismail. I have nothing left in my slides. Everybody else has talked about my slides. So modifiable risk factors and unmodifiable risk factors. Okay, so unmodifiable, the genetics you are born with. Girls with lipodystrophy can give birth to children with androgen excess exposure in the intrauterine life, and they will be having an increased tendency to develop PCOS. Girls who are born with PCOS, when they become pregnant, then they can have children with a risk for PCOS, which is about 5 times more. So we always say, I think that fits perfectly for PCOS. It is the mother's PCOS condition which puts the child also at a risk. Please remember, there are not only obese PCOS, you also have lean PCOS. Without obesity, you can have PCOS. So that is about 10 to 20% of PCOS can be thin, can be fit. I have a basketball player who has PCOS. So you should remember, PCOS does not happen only because of obesity. It can happen due to a number of other factors too. So this is actually a data which I took out of my sister's hospital. We did a short study. So out of the PCOS who had come for treatment in young women, obese were 88%, overweight were 44%, and obese was 44%. Lean PCOS was 12%. And the mean age at menarche was not delayed. It was as normal as all the other patients who had come in. What are the clues we are getting from thin PCOS girls? Elevated testosterone, dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate, androstenedione, LH, insulin resistance. And these are all related, directly related to the insulin level. So you should remember, even if you are thin, you can develop PCOS. Okay, so this is one of my girl who came at 4 years of age. The mom was deeply worried, looking at the amount of hair she has on the back. Just look at the amount of hair she has. But she doesn't have hair on the face. So this is actually a vellus hypertrichosis, and this is a non-sexual hair, and this is not a sexual hair. And usually you should remember, the features of PCOS are much more evident after onset of puberty. So that's the next point I wanted to raise. So your features of PCOS are evident only after onset of puberty, but you will have minor clues even from a young age on these children having a risk for PCOS later, and you should intervene now. So this is vellus hypertrichosis. This is usually familial. Ask the parent whether the dad has body hair, the mom has body hair, and these are fine. These are asexual hair. And this has nothing to do with PCOS. Okay, this is premature puberty. You will see any number of children coming into your clinic with premature puberty. A few fine thin hair in the pubic region, which does not increase too much, does not become too much. You don't see any changes of estrogenization of the vulva. You don't have changes of telarche. You don't have anything else but minor thin pubic hair, and the family is worried. This is premature puberty. This is a very important clue. These children are at risk for PCOS as soon as their puberty starts. And these are children where you should institute modifiable risk factors can be modified. Your diet, your exercise should start now, not when the child has gone into adolescence and has started PCOS-like features. They don't listen to you. I think Dr. Newton mentioned that girls in the adolescent age group only exercise for 10 minutes a day. Boys exercise for 45 minutes. You need at least minimum of 30 to 60 minutes of moderate degree aerobic exercise, like Lakshmi Shanti said, and they're not going to listen to you when they go into puberty. They've already turned into a couch potato. So this age is the time when you intervene to prevent the PCOS. So premature puberty is an important clue for later risk for PCOS. And there is one group in Spain which is working on using drugs like metformin, pioglitazone, and flutamide. I'm not at all for it. You don't know the long-term risks of that. So it is much better to institute lifestyle modifications rather than trying drugs. And this age is the appropriate age to try treatment. Okay, this is an established case. So this is a teenager who's deeply depressed. He's got severe acanthosis nigricans, hirsutism. And I think all of you know about your Ferriman-Galway scoring. So which is anything more than 8 is a significant hirsutism. Please remember, hirsutism is much more common in South Indian population. It may not be that much evident in a child of a North Indian origin. You have to remember, people are moving about in the country. So just because they do not have hirsutism does not mean they don't have hyperandrogenism. They can have other clinical features of hyperandrogenism. So the etiology of PCOS, it could be genetic, it could be environmental. So you are born. I always talk about having two children in the family. Both of them inherit one set, a haplotype, a 23 chromosomes from their mom and 23 chromosomes from their dad. But then when they grow up, you see one child having early puberty and being of an average height, the other child having late puberty and being tall. So where did this come from? The mom is short, and the mom is short and intelligent. The dad is tall but a bit dull. I think Ismail relates to it a bit. But then the child is so worried because he was born short and dull. At least the mother was short and intelligent. The father was tall and dull. But he had the worst of both features. So what does that mean? That is the environmental influence. So you get the same genetic sequence from your parents, but one character is exhibited, but else the other character is inhibited. So that is methylation. This is dependent on the maternal nutrition. So if the mom's nutrition is not good, everybody was talking about the mother needing iron, the mother needing, there is a study going on in Mysore from Holdsworth Memorial Hospital with the team from UK. They're trying to institute B12 and B-complex vitamins in the mother to see if it would improve the health of the offspring, the metabolic health of the offspring. So Holdsworth Memorial Hospital is on a huge study. It's actually a community-based study. So the maternal health is extremely important. So you're going to start prevention of PCOS from looking at the health of the mother, the health during pregnancy, because to prevent SGA, then during birth, and then the immediate infantile period, prevention of catch-up growth, and then avoiding risk factors that can happen because of precocious puberty. And then all of these steps will prevent PCOS in the adolescence. Adolescence is almost the final step and the PCOS has started. That's a little bit late in the initiation of treatment, because Ismail was very specific that I don't talk too much about exotic drugs. And as such, also treatment of PCOS is 95% lifestyle modification and medication is less than 5%. I would say less than 2% is the treatment based on medication. Lifestyle modification is the backbone of therapy for polycystic ovarian syndrome. So in utero androgen excess programs later PCOS at adulthood. So there are two hypotheses, prenatal androgen hypothesis and adipose expandability hypothesis. I think, again, I will come back to Dr. Newton's Bacchus hypothesis. So you have smaller fat cells. please remember, for all of your information, fat is also an endocrine organ. It has so many hormones. It's got adipokine, it's got leptin, it's got bisphatin, and so many other hormones are being produced by a fat cell. A fat cell is a endocrine organ, and there are so many hormones coming out of it. So the fat actually is altered by the intrauterine environment so that it is unable, whenever you have extra fat, I always talk about in Tamil, பஞ்சத்தில் அடிபட்டவனுக்கு நிறைய சாப்பாடு கொடுத்தா இல்லை நிறைய அரிசி மூட்டை கொடுத்தீங்கன்னா they won't cook everything immediately. They will store it for future when they cannot have enough food. So that is how your epigenetic malformations happen, modification happen. ஒரு குழந்தை ஒரு அம்மாவுக்கு பிறக்கும் போது சின்ன வெயிட்டாக பிறந்தா உள்ளுக்குள்ளார பிளசண்டாக சரியாக வளரலை. அப்போ அந்த குழந்தை பஞ்சத்தில் அடிபட்டு போச்சு. ஸோ அந்த குழந்தையோட கொழுப்பு மாறிடும், அதோட உருவத்தை மாத்திடும், அதோட வேலையை மாத்திடும். அப்போ கொஞ்சம் சாப்பாடு கொடுத்தாலே நிறைய கொழுப்பா ஸ்டோர் பண்ணும். யூ நீட் ஒன்லி லிட்டில் ஃபுட் டு பிகம் ஃபேட் ஏர்லியர் இன் ஸ்மால் ஃபார் ஜெஸ்டேஷன் ஏஜ் இன்ஃபன்ட்ஸ். தட் இஸ் த பேக் போன் ஆஃப் த பார்க்கர்ஸ் ஹைபோதசிஸ். யூ ஹாவ் பீன் கண்டிஷன் பை த என்வாயன்மெண்ட் யூ ஆர் எக்ஸ்போஸ்ட் இன் த இன்ட்ரயூட்ரைன் லைஃப். பஞ்சத்தில் அடிபட்டதுனால நிறைய சாப்பாடு கிடைக்கும் போது யூ வில் ஸ்டோர் இட் அஸ் ஃபேட். Please remember, there is transgenerational. That is, the child of this child can also be affected by the same. It is going to take at least 2 generations of good, healthy nutrition to get a good society with a healthy metabolism. So, in the kulandai panjathil adipatta, adoda kulandaikku adhe effect varum. Because that has been proved by one study in preterms by Dr. Sarah Mathai from CMC Bangalore. She has actually worked on preterms and the transgenerational transformation of information across the across generations for the metabolic defects. So you have to remember, in the samudayathile, in the generation mattumilla, idhukku adutha generationum nalla irundhatha Indian society is going to be healthy. Till then, the Indian subcontinent, particularly the South Indian subcontinent, is at a higher risk for metabolic diseases and at smaller weight gains. You don't have to be huge, even small weight gains will put you at a higher risk for diseases in later life. So critical periods in fetal life, periods of rapid stress, I think Dr. Newton has already alluded to all this earlier. So changes in gene expression without alteration in DNA sequence. Get the same gene, but the way your genes are expressed are dependent on the environment you are exposed to, both intrauterine and extrauterine. So SGA or prematurity versus PCOS. So they have increased incidence of precocious puberty. They have an increased incidence for risk of, and they have an increased risk for overweight and obesity. This overweight and obesity makes them at a risk for PCOS. They have pronounced puberty. And they have, remember, androgens are produced from 2 sources. One is the ovary, the other is the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland is under the control of the ACTH. The ovary is under the control of the LH. So when you have PCOS, you have high LH, this leads to functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. So 17 OHP adrenal mattum illa ovary liye irukku, and the 17 OHP becomes more active in children who have all these risk factors and start producing more androgens from the ovary. So this is another child with precocious or premature puberty. So this is associated with hyperinsulinism, and this can lead, and this worsens it. The ovarian hyperandrogenism is worsened by this, and this is a very vicious cycle that can happen. So PCOS in women born SGA is twice the incidence of those born appropriate for gestational age. They have hyperandrogenism, their sex hormone binding globulin is low. Again, your muscle mass comes into action here, as Dr. Newton was mentioning about the muscle mass in SGA. Sex hormone binding globulin is lower in these girls. So modifiable risk factor. Or SGA with catch-up weight. You're born SGA, that's unmodifiable. But you can modify the catch-up weight, diet and exercise, and seeing that the mothers who give birth to these children are healthy. What are the unmodifiable risk factor? A family member with PCOS. The risk for PCOS in the child is 5 times more. Androgen excess conditions in the mother. SGA, large for gestational age infants. And then lipodystrophy, genetic insulin resistance syndromes and others, these அந்த சொத்த ஒன்னு செய்ய முடியாது. அட்லீஸ்ட் இனிமே சேர்க்கிற சொத்தையாவது நல்ல சொத்தா சேர்த்துக்கலாம். So this is a case scenario of 15-year-old girl born SGA, birth weight 1.9 kilograms. See, you also have to remember SGA does not fit into one just cut off mark. Like we all studied in Meherban Singh, less than 2.5 kg is SGA, more than 2.5 kg is AHA. It's not like that. It is just a range of weights. So across the weight, as you grow lower and lower, your risk factors become more and more. As you grow higher and higher, 3 kgs is actually an appropriate weight. Anything more than 2.7 to 2.8, they have better outcomes. Even less than 2.8, we see risk factors for similar to other SGAs, but it is worse in even smaller babies. She's worried about dark, thick facial hair, depressed and refused to attend school. And mother has similar facial hair, but less severe. And this is the girl which we talked about. So she's obese, her waist-hip ratio. Remember, again, the adipose expandability tissue. வயத்துல இருக்கிற தொப்பைதான் இருக்கிறதுல உலகத்திலேயே மோசமான கொழுப்பு. மனசுல இருக்கிற கொழுப்பை விட தொப்பையில இருக்கிற கொழுப்பு தான் வேர்ஸான கொழுப்பு. பிகாஸ் தட் இஸ் ஆல்மோஸ்ட் ப்ரொபோர்ஷனல் டு த விசரல் ஃபேட் தட் யூ ஹேவ் விச் இஸ் இன் த லிவர். த விசரல் ஃபேட் இஸ் த மெட்டபாலிக்கலி ஆக்டிவ் ஃபேட் அண்ட் ஆக்சுவலி ஆல்டர்ஸ் அண்ட் வர்சன்ஸ் யுவர் மெட்டபாலிசம் இன் லேட்டர் லைஃப். ஸோ யுவர் விசரல் ஃபேட் இஸ் ஆல்மோஸ்ட் ப்ரொபோர்ஷனல். தட் இஸ் வை இஃப் யூ லுக் அட் ஆல் இந்தியன் மேல்ஸ் ஹூ கெட் மேரிட் வித் இன் த 2 months, த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் property they acquire is the toppa. The abdominal fat is the first the gain you get from the marriage, even more than the happiness from anything else. After all the parties and all the food festivals, all your family members invited you to, that will come and all your metabolism will go haywire. It is not the wife who spoiled you, it is the food that spoiled you. So you can't blame your wife for everything in your life. That's for you, this man. Severe hirsutism, Ferriman Galway scoring. Acne is again a sign of hyperandrogenism. Skin tags. You see small, small black skin tags. That is also actually a sign of hyperandrogenism. That is not something that is just a structural or something that a dermatologist worries about. It's a sign of hyperandrogenism. Severe acanthosis. But remember, acanthosis is not proportional to the amount of insulin resistance you have. So this is your Ferriman Galway score. It is available on the internet. It's a score of 1, 2, 3 and 4 depending on the intensity. It is scored on 9 different areas. The maximum score is 36. Anything more than 8 is severe hirsutism. It's hirsutism. So diagnostic criteria for PCOS, you should have at least 2. Clinical or biochemical signs of hyperandrogenism, oligoanovulation and polycystic ovaries. All of these are not important in children. If you suspect, but please remember, be very, very careful about labeling somebody PCOS. You should wait at least for 2 years post puberty before you can even think of labeling them as PCOS. Unless they have excessive clinical features of PCOS, please be very, very careful of labeling somebody as a PCOS. But you should exclude other etiologies like congenital adrenal hyperplasia, androgen secreting tumors, or Cushing syndrome. So in children, adolescents, they say all three features. It is not important to have only clinical features. You have to document hyperandrogens in the blood. You should have oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea at least for 2 years post-menarche, because as such, girls have irregular periods for the first 2 years post-puberty. And then or primary amenorrhea at age 16 years, and the ovarian volume is important. It should be more than 10 centimeters cubed to diagnose polycystic ovaries in girls. And you should remember that mala mari or appearance report. Whereas the cysts in hypothyroidism will be huge, water-filled, clefted cysts, whereas the cyst will be arranged like a rosette in a child with polycystic ovarian disease. So I think the investigations will come later, clinical judgment itself, and you can institute steps. Only when they have significant morbidity, because of that, you should intervene with drugs. So this is one of my girl. I think this is the same girl who was in the front. So she's a polycystic ovarian disease. This is another girl, same age group. She also came. She had delayed puberty, 14 years, has not had any changes. So she actually was a non-classic congenital adrenal hyperplasia who had been missed till 14 years of age. It's very difficult to differentiate between severe PCOS and non-classic congenital adrenal hyperplasia. And this is a place for investigation where you have to rule out what the reason is. Third, this is a very, very famous model called Harman Kaur in the UK. She models with her beard. So I think in this adolescence where you were all talking about body image, I think you have to teach them to learn acceptance. This girl had actually tried to, she attempted suicide about a few years ago. Then she learned to accept that her body is there. She stopped shaving. She stopped responding to bullies. And now she goes around with a beard. She's a lean PCOS with a beard and models like that. And she's actually a motivational speaker in the UK. So virilizing CAH versus polycystic ovarian disease, a bit difficult to judge without doing investigations. K treatment is individualized. It cannot be one all be all, or it cannot be one size cannot fit everyone. Lifestyle modification is the cornerstone of therapy. For hirsutism, please don't do shaving, depilation or waxing before reducing the androgen excess in the blood. Only after you achieve reduction in androgen excess, you can initiate the final treatment for hirsutism with local measures. If you keep doing laser, it's about 40,000, 50,000 rupees for a few sessions of laser therapy, depending on where you go. It may be even more expensive, and finally you don't achieve anything because you've not noy nadi, noy modal nadi, adu nadi vaipa chel Thirukkural. You have to look after the basic disease first before you try treatment modalities. So the androgen excess has to be brought down before you initiate local steps. Metformin, there are also talks about pioglitazones and GLP-1 agonists. Liraglutide has been approved for therapy in adolescents also with obesity. But I think we have to wait to try. I always wait for 10 years to see where the side effects are going before I try anything in children. Oral contraceptive pills, the pros and cons of a low dose versus high dose ethinyl estradiol. Anti-androgens, spironolactone, finasteride and flutamide. I'm very, very comfortable with spironolactone. I'm a bit worried about finasteride and flutamide. And hepatic side effects are something which really worries me. So this is one of my girls and a heroine. So she actually came with a look at the amount of beard she has. She was so depressed. And please see, this is the same girl. I've not changed the girl. It's the same. And she's also wearing the same earring to satisfy me, I think. So she actually went through lifestyle modification, dropped. You don't have to drop too much. I'll come to that slide later. She dropped a bit of her weight, and then we instituted measures to reduce her androgens. We did not even go to laser therapy. All her hair started dropping on its own. It takes time. It takes at least minimum of 1.5 to 2 years to achieve a reasonable outcome. So diet and exercise and PCOS, differences in dietary intake and physical activity alone cannot explain difference in weight between women with and without PCOS. Konja confusing ah irukku. So saapradhunaley exercise panadhunaley PCOS varama irukka poradhu kedaadhu, but adu better ah ungala improve pannadhukku udhavum. So 2 to 5% weight loss pogum to improve several parameters that are associated with PCOS, which includes insulin sensitivity, your heart disease risk, homocysteine, androgens, abdominal fat, menstrual regularity, lipid profile, fertility. Just 2 to 5% weight loss, which is achievable. So, Ilivarandu unbaan kan inbam pol nitkum kalipeer irayan kan noi. Pleasure dwells within those who eat moderately. Disease dwells within those who eat gluttonly. So, this is our ancient Thirukkural, which is more than 2,500 years old. So, lifestyle modification, I think it's already been talked about enough. So, diet, exercise and behavior therapy. Exercise more than, I think, a minimum of 60 minutes daily, and it should be moderate intensity. Reduce saturated and trans fat and glycemic load. So 30%, like Lakshmi Shanti said, 30% fat, 15% protein, 55% carbs, and trans saturated fat should be less than 10%. High in cereal fiber and polyunsaturated fat. No smoking or alcohol. Again, HEDS has to be done when the child enters adolescence, not when they're going through adolescence. So that is a mandatory requirement in our diabetes clinic abroad. At 10 years of age, we start our counseling for adolescence. By 10 to 12 years, it's the time when we are transitioning them into the adolescent clinic. We would already have started all our counseling, seen that our counseling is done. We have taken HEDS. We have also done enough to see that they don't go into that bad behavior as much as possible. We've tried our best before they enter adolescence. So I think the time for intervention is 10 to 12 years and not after you enter adolescence. Reduce stress and family support. Weight loss through lifestyle modification, as I already said. Avoid crash diets, and I think all of them have mentioned it again. Short-term weight loss. Aggressive surgical approach is not necessary. Please be very, very careful about the advocation of bariatric surgery. It has important and excellent criteria that has to be fulfilled before you suggest bariatric surgery for somebody. It is suggested for people with specific body mass index of so much and so much percentage more than that, plus 2 severe associated comorbidities, and when their lifespan is going to be compromised. Otherwise, bariatric surgery is not for adolescents. But it has a role to play in really severe situations. So, but it is not an aggressive surgical approach for everyone. Sensible, sustainable diet pattern, and I already mentioned 30% fat, where less than 10% is saturated, 15% protein and 55% carbs. So this is another of my girls. She's a congenital, non-classical, late on the CAH. Look at how depressed. Just look at her lips. She's got such a sad look. A frontal baldness, recessive frontal baldness. And then the same girl, after adequate and successful treatment, she is now finished college and she's doing extremely well. So it is possible to achieve the best for your children. And I think the pediatricians can watch for children born from high-risk scenario. And any early feature suggesting a risk can evoke advice for early lifestyle intervention. Prevention is better than cure. And empathetic advice of pediatricians helps family to institute early remedial measures. Thanks.
தேங்க் யூ அகிலா. இந்த மாதிரி நல்ல ஒரு புரியும்படி கருத்துக்களை சொல்றது தான் எங்களுக்கு ஒன்றை ஹெவியாக லைக் பண்ண வைக்குது. We are looking forward for a endocrinology series for the pediatricians. IAP will try and approach you for that and we will soon contact you on that aspect. And very reasonably and very clearly dealt with the subject. And I think pediatrician will really have some take-home messages. And I think they will be very clear about what is PCOS mean.
உண்மையா சொல்லிடுங்க. உண்மையா புரிஞ்சுதா?
மனசை தொட்டு சொல்றேன். மனசை தொட்டு சொல்றேன். ரூம் போட்டு யோசிச்சு சொல்லல. Very good, very good. I think, I don't know what Usha is going to do with that. After that, you have done everything. Is Usha there?
Yeah, I'm there. So yeah. Having listened to the whole scenario, the whole thing in the afternoon, I think everybody did an excellent job. And Ahila's was a muttaipu. And I think I'm like an Anumar wall, but still you need the wall sometime. So
yes. One minute, I'll introduce you, Usha.
Yeah, please.
Of course, Dr. Usha is a practicing pediatrician in Coimbatore. She is very much interested in adolescent. And she's going to be the president of the Adolescent Health Academy, which is going to be instituted very soon, the Coimbatore chapter. And she is very well-versed and a very person who has got immense experience in dealing with an adolescent. With these few words, I invite Usha for her message.
Do the finale.
Yeah.
Well, I think everything was dealt with a lot of clarity and with a lot of professionalism. So I think very little is there. So I think the highlight of the whole afternoon was this exercise bit, the lifestyle modification and recognition of PCOS and the approach to it and all that. So I think the exercise bit, the lifestyle modification, not only for PCOS, but even for any adolescent for that matter, should be introduced much earlier in life. Even this should be part and parcel of the school curriculum, which I'm always working on whenever we go to schools to do the adolescent program. And in the lifestyle modification, the highlight of the thought I had was setting the right goals is the most important step. Having very effective goals, the goals being very realistic and attainable goals, especially for these adolescent PCOS to lose weight and to have a good lose the facial hirsutism and be very presentable. For example, this is one type of job which is easily said than done. Having all of us gone through these weight loss goals throughout our lives, it's very easily said, but exercise more is a fine goal, but it is not very specific for an adolescent. We can easily tell them walk 5 miles or do 30 minutes every day. But is it attainable? Is it measurable or is it achievable? That's what we have to think. So this 30 minutes to 40 minutes per day, sometimes I come across adolescents who have just not motivated enough to do even the 30 minutes. So it could be 10 minutes split through the day for that 40 minutes. As long as they don't have the sitting syndrome, we should just motivate them to do that 30 to 40 minutes, PCOS or not PCOS too. So at least we could give them a goal of walking 30 to 40 minutes, 5 days a week, which is very specific, achievable, and is quite forgiving. And according to the diet, I had a question for Ahila because I'm also I was also propagating keto diet for some of the adolescents who have morbid obesity. And running a sports center, we do give them some kind of programs to lose weight. So the carbohydrate being 30%, and little higher fat and protein 15%. it did help a lot of adolescents I came across to lose weight. Do you advocate that? That's a question to Aguila. I personally experienced for some adolescents with very good results. Now, regarding diet, I think most Lakshmi Shanti, Dr. Newton all had covered it very well. A sensible diet and a changing eating habits is very long-term. The percentage of calories has already been discussed, like 1,000 to 1,200. Weight loss program has been discussed, cutting down on the salt intake, reducing. So all that has already been stressed upon. Only thing I needed to add was this kind of a ketogenic diet, does it help these children? And exercise, start as early as possible, and let's introduce in schools. Let's try to contact people to take the message to school saying that this has to be started as early as possible in schools, starting from first standard onwards. That is my this thing, so that it becomes part and parcel of life. I think most of it has been discussed.
Yeah, I'll answer that question, Usha. For ketogenic diet, it has too much of fat. We don't know the long-term effects of what we are doing. Any change in your vasculature, say in insulin resistance, it is the increase in nitrous oxide and reduction in the pulsatility of your vasculature, which actually leads to the deposition of cholesterol on your vessel walls. That is the start. So you should actually remember diabetes and hypertension, rendipair annantambi. They are coming from the same parents. They're only actually a difference in the way they have been born. So it's actually the basic pathology is the same. Both diabetes and hypertension are the same pathology. It's the non-pulsatility of the vasculature which leads to the deposition of cholesterol on that. So in children who are already obese and they have insulin resistance, trying to put in so much of fat, I mean, there's no long-term data on how is it going to affect them in the long run. So I would actually say, இயற்கைக்கு மாறா எதுவும் செய்ய வேண்டாம். ஐ ஆல்வேஸ் டெல் ஃபேமிலிஸ், உங்க கொள்ளு பாட்டி கொள்ளு தாத்தா என்ன சாப்பிட்டாங்களோ அதை சாப்பிடுறேன். இன் தோஸ் டேஸ் ஃபார் தீபாவளி அண்ட் பொங்கல், வி ஹேட் தீபாவளிக்கு ஒரே ஒரு அதிர்ஷ்டம் தான் எங்க பாட்டி தருவாங்க. அதுவும் பேத்திக்குன்னா சின்னதா கிடைக்கும், பேரனுக்குன்னா கொஞ்சம் பெருசா கிடைக்கும். ஸோ ஒரு அதிர்ஷ்டம் தீபாவளிக்கு. பொங்கலுக்கு சக்கரை பொங்கல், நெய்யெல்லாம் ஊத்த மாட்டாங்க கிராமத்துல, நாலு அப்புதான் அப்பா வாங்க கேட்டாக்க. அப்புறம் கோயில் திருவிழாக்கு மாவிளக்கு கிடைக்கும், மூணு தான் ஸ்வீட் வருஷத்துக்கு. So that's all you can have. You can't have sweets every day just because Araya or Ananda Bhavan managed to open one branch in every street in your space. So the lifestyle your grandparents followed is, and they never had a vehicle to go. So maattu vandi illa moote da yetuvaanga maaduku valikkunu aal yera matanga maattu vandi illa pakkathula nadandhu dhaan povaanga. So 22 km nadandhu poi dhaan nell vikkinom. So you walk 22 km and you had so much of rice. Now you sit and eat so much of rice than that. So it's actually the balance. I would say I wouldn't go for any food fat. I would just say a regular sensible diet with high fiber. And anyway, in those days, kai kutal. Orala da idikin arisi. Adilela polish varavalik ella adiyum devu. Konja kurne odda varu. Konja mela apdi umi odda varu. Adho chethu da vendu da saapanum. So that was a very, very good diet. So I would say a sensible diet which everybody followed for years together. That would be actually much better. Only thing, அளவுக்கு மீறினால் அமிர்தமும் நஞ்சு, which holds good for any food. I would say I wouldn't go for high fat diet at all because I don't know the long term effects. And the data is still pending. It's only short term data which have come out. There is no long term data on that.
Okay, Dr. Akila, one more question from Dr. Arunachalam from Nagarkoil. What will happen to the, I don't know what does he mean, what will happen to the endocrine system? Dr. Arunachalam, you're there?
எண்டோக்ரைன் சிஸ்டம் நான் தான் சொல்லிட்டேன், கொழுப்பே எண்டோக்ரைன் சிஸ்டம் சொல்லிடுறேன், கொழுப்பு கூடி போயிடும்.
ஆன்சர், யூ ஆர் வெரி ஆப்வியஸ் இன் யுவர் ஆன்சர்ஸ். குட். சோ எனி अदर யூ வாண்ட் டு ஆட் समथिंग?
டைரக்டாவே ஒரு கேக் சொல்றேன், நேருக்கு நேர் போய். டாக்டர்
அருணாச்சலம்,
ஐ ஹேவ் ஒன் மோர் क्वेश्चन அகிலா. யூ ஹேவ் எனி अदर ட்ரக்ஸ் இன்டிகேட்டட் ஃபார் ஹிஸ் அபார்ட் ஃப்ரம் மெட்ஃபார்மின்? லைக் ரிமெம்பர் சம், ஐ ஹவ் சீன் சம் பிரிஸ்கிரிப்ஷன், சம் ஆஃப் தம் யூசிங் ரோசிக்ளிட்டசோன். Some of them still using those drugs.
No, okay. So glitazones are very good for reducing insulin resistance. But remember, there is one unknown effect which not many people or any article mentioned. It affects the function of the osteoblasts. In the long run, you will lose your bone mineral density, and puberty is the period where you go through maximum bone mass accrual in your life. Your lifetime bone mass accrual, the maximum happens during puberty. And if you're going to interfere with the accrual by using drugs, your long-term bone health is going to be affected. So you can't sacrifice for that sake. What I use, metformin also will not work for hirsutism. For hirsutism, what we do is after diet and exercise, you have to use anti-androgens, where spironolactone is an excellent drug. The next one I use is cyproterone acetate. And these are, I've only had to use these two and I've had excellent results. So I haven't gone beyond that so far.
ஓகே தேங்க்யூ அகிலா இந்த கடையை மூடினா தான் நம்ம போய் எல்லாரும் அந்த கடையை திறக்க முடியும்
ஓகே டாக்டர்